Good morning and welcome. My name is Heather Rakosi Russell, and I'm the Associate Vice President for Residential Life here at Notre Dame. And it's my distinct honor this morning to introduce to you one of our keynote speakers, John L. Allen. John Allen is the prize-winning senior correspondent for the National Catholic Reporter and the senior Vatican analyst for CNN. He's the author of 7 best-selling books on the Vatican and Catholic affairs and writes frequently on the church for major national and international publications. He's also a popular speaker on the Catholic affairs, both in the United States and abroad. The London Tablet has called Allen the most authoritative writer on Vatican affairs in the English language. And renowned papal biographer George Weigel has called him the best Anglican Vatican reporter ever. When Allen was called upon to put the first question to Pope Benedict aboard the papal plane en route to the United States in April 2008, the Vatican spokesperson said to the Pope, "Holy Father, this man needs no introduction." That's not just the Vatican's judgment either. Veteran religion writer Kenneth Woodward of Newsweek described Allen as the journalist other reporters, and not just a few cardinals, look to for the inside story and how all the Pope's men direct the world's largest church. Allen's work is admired across ideological divides. Liberal commentator Father Andrew Greeley calls his writing indispensable, while the late Father Richard John Newhouse, a conservative, called Allen's reporting possibly the best source of information on the Vatican published in the United States. His weekly internet column, All Things Catholic, is widely read as a source of insight on the global church. Allen's most recent book is People of Hope, an extended interview with Archbishop Timothy Dolan of New York. John divides his time between Rome and his home in Denver, Colorado. He grew up in Western Kansas and holds a master's degree in religious studies from the University of Kansas. Please join me this morning in welcoming our guest, John Allen.
Thanks, Heather. Appreciate it. Hello there. Can everyone hear?
Yes.
Outstanding. Well, it is an honor to be with you here today. And listen, I know that you have a jam-packed schedule over these next couple of days, and our time together is limited. So I promise you, I am going to try to be brief. As Henry VIII said to each of his wives, "I won't keep you long." But I do think there probably is a preliminary bit of business we ought to deal with before we dive into the meat of things here this morning, because I've been asked to talk to you about the future of the Catholic Church in the 21st century and what it portends for Catholic higher education. And that, of course, is a fairly sweeping subject. I don't know about you, but I always like to know a little bit something about where a guy is coming from before I listen to them pontificate on a subject like that. So I thought I would begin today with just a quick bit of background about the work I do, because it might help explain the perspective I bring to this conversation. Okay? So here it is in a nutshell. I am what the Italians call a Vaticanista, which means that it is my full-time professional work to keep an eye on that 108-acre island of ecclesiastical life in the heart of Rome that we call the Vatican, and to use that as a launching pad for sort of keeping track of what's percolating around the broader Catholic world. So in concrete, what that means is I lived in Rome about full-time for 10 years. I now spend about a third of every year in Rome. And when I'm there, almost every day, I'm in and out of some office of the Roman Curia, that's the central administrative bureaucracy of the church, trying to figure out what's going on. Although, to be honest with you, you should know that these visits inside Vatican offices tend to be kind of pro forma events. They're courtesy calls. There's not a lot of actual information exchange. If you want to know where you really get the scoop on what's happening in Rome, it is, of course, over meals. Okay? And yes, ladies and gentlemen, I am aware it is a real burden of my office that so much of it is done over lengthy Roman lunches and dinners. But I want you to know I am over there carrying the cross for all of you. Now, in addition to that, I also move when the Pope moves. So I took about 54 trips under John Paul II to about 65 countries. I've taken almost all of Benedict XVI's foreign trips. I'll be with him again in September when he goes to Lebanon. And the story I want to tell you to illustrate my perspective is arises from one of these trips. Now, you may know that the Pope travels in a kind of unique dual capacity, because the Pope is both a head of state. The Holy See is a sovereign entity under international law. It has diplomatic relations with 179 countries. And so when he arrives in a foreign country, he is always welcomed the first time in a very formal diplomatic setting by the president or the prime minister or the monarch, if it's a country that has a monarch or whatever. But the Pope is also, of course, the head of the Catholic Church. So he's also welcomed a second time, usually in a less formal way, on behalf of the local Catholic community. And generally, this welcome would be delivered by, say, the local bishop or the president of the bishop's conference or the primate, if it's one of those European countries that has a Catholic primate like Armagh in Ireland or Toledo in Spain or whatever. But if it's a very, very small Catholic country that doesn't have its own hierarchy, that is, doesn't have its own bishops, sometimes the welcome will be done by the papal nuncio, that's the Pope's ambassador in that country, who by tradition always holds the rank of archbishop. And this story is set on one such occasion. It's John Paul's 2002 trip to Azerbaijan. Now, at the time, there were a grand total of 114 Catholics in Azerbaijan. I actually did the math, ladies and gentlemen. It would have been four times less expensive to fly all of them to Rome. But that, of course, wasn't the point. And there were no bishops in Azerbaijan, and so therefore on this occasion the welcome was delivered by the nuncio, who at the time was a very kindly, elderly Italian monsignore. Okay, a real salt of the earth guy. He's since gone to his reward. As I say, a wonderful, warm-hearted, open, bright man. But he had a reputation, and I am here to tell you folks it was a well-deserved reputation, as a bit of a windbag. Huh? That is, he had this remarkable Italian oratorical capacity to just go on and on and on. And the miracle of it is, without ever saying anything. Huh? I mean, you'd be listening to these sentences in Italian, asking yourself, where the hell are the verbs? Because nothing ever seemed to be happening in any of these sentences. Now, this day, our Monsignore friend was in rare form. I actually clocked this greeting, folks, at 40 minutes. And bear in mind, this was a 24-hour trip. We thought John Paul would be back in Rome before this guy was done welcoming him to Baku, you know? Now, I was in the press pool, which meant that I was at the end of one row of seats, and there was a very narrow aisle. Immediately across the aisle was the Vatican Seguito, that's the entourage, the cardinals and other senior officials who travel with the Pope, which meant I was more or less cheek by jowl with a very senior Vatican cardinal. A guy I know very well, I've interviewed him many times over the years. And I could tell, as this welcome was winding on, that the cardinal was becoming increasingly frustrated. I mean, you can tell these things, right? Because his breathing was becoming more labored, and veins were throbbing on his forehead, and so on. And at one stage, I thought the guy was going to burst. So I leaned across the aisle, and I whispered to him, "Cardinal, what do you think?" Well, there was this nanosecond of calculation. You could tell he's thinking, should I say this, should I not say it? But it was obvious he needed to get this off his chest. So the cardinal leans into me, and looking up at this Italian Monsignore going on and on and saying nothing, in sort of sotto voce fashion, the cardinal whispered, "You realize that some Italian village is missing its idiot." Now, in addition to being a once-in-a-career punchline, okay, this story, I think, makes a valuable point, which is that only seen from afar could the Vatican look like a sort of Stepford Wives environment in which everyone dresses alike and talks alike and acts alike and thinks alike. It's not an organism with a central nervous system that thinks only one thought at a time. It's instead a complex bureaucracy. And yes, there is kind of a corporate culture there, but that encompasses a wide variety of personalities and temperaments and agenda and all of that. In other words, when you see it on an up-close and personal basis, what reveals itself is the complexity. You'll learn to see the shades of gray in between the black and the white, to debunk the stereotypes and see the reality as it lays. And I hope that some of the same perspective I can bring to you here this morning as we try to noodle our way through some of the challenges facing the Catholic Church in the early 21st century and their implications for the mission of Catholic higher education. Okay? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you three descriptive observations about what I would see as core forces currently at work in the Catholic Church, shaping both our today and our tomorrow. So three empirical realities, not hunches or guesses or opinions, but what I intend to be descriptive statements about forces currently at work at the church, in the church. And then I'm going to try to tease out of those three observations three mission statements, if you like, for the business of Catholic higher education. Okay, I'm going to try to do all of that, just so you know, in about 30 minutes or so. So we'll also have some time for Q&A at the end and find out what you want to talk about. All right, that's the game plan. All right, so let's start with three descriptive observations about the Catholic Church. I'm going to tick them off, and then I'll unpack them for you. I would submit to you that in the early 21st century, we are, one, an increasingly global church, two, an increasingly evangelical church, and three, an increasingly tribalized church. So global, evangelical, and tribalized. As I say, I'm going to unpack each, and then we'll come to what they mean for Catholic higher education. Let's start with global. The famous Jesuit theologian Karl Rahner once said that in the long run of history, the Second Vatican Council in the mid-1960s would be remembered as that moment when the Catholic Church became a self-consciously global family of faith. That is, no longer tied exclusively to its European and later North American heritage, but truly global. Now, Rahner was making a theological argument. What I want to submit to you is that Catholic demography in the 20th and 21st centuries lends triumphant empirical confirmation to that point. Let me give you some basic numbers. In 1900, at the dawn of the 20th century, there were 266 million Catholics in the world, 266, of whom 200 million lived in Europe and North America, and just 66 million every place else. They were principally in Latin America. This, of course, was before the population explosion of the 20th century. Okay? Now let's run the clock forward to the year 2000, at the end of the 20th century. At that stage, there were 1.1 billion Catholics in the world, of whom 740 million lived in the global south, Latin America, Asia, Africa, Oceania, the Middle East, with the balance about 360 million or so in Europe and North America. To put that point differently, just one century ago, two-thirds of the global Catholic population lived in the Northern Hemisphere. One century later, it was the exact reverse. Two-thirds lived in the Southern Hemisphere. And if we run the clock forward to 2050, the middle of this century, the projection is that by that point, the Southern share of the global Catholic total will be three-quarters. In other words, within the arc of our lifetimes, three out of every four Catholic men, women, and children alive will be living in the global south. This, ladies and gentlemen, is the most profound, most sweeping, most dramatic transformation of Catholic demography in more than 2,000 years of church history, and we are living through it right now. Okay? Now, there are two implications to those numbers that I like to unpack for American audiences. Start with this one, number one. I know it is easy to believe, depending on where you live in the United States, that we are living through a period of Catholic decline, of things getting smaller. Because sometimes this is what we see, again, depending on where you live. You may see parishes clustering. You may see schools closing. We struggle to keep our hospitals and our social service operations afloat. We struggle to hand on the faith to the next generation. We look at data such as that that came from the Pew Forum study of the religious landscape in America 2 years ago that found that there are now 22 million ex-Catholics in the United States, that the ex-Catholics in this country would be the second largest religious denomination in the country if they thought of themselves that way. We look at all that data and we think we are living through a period of entropy, of decline, of contraction. And look, if those are the realities in your own backyard, they are, of course, very true to your experience. But let's be clear, this is not the global Catholic story of our time. Instead, the global Catholic story of our time is massive, phenomenal, breakneck, runaway growth. We are living through the greatest period of missionary expansion in the history of Roman Catholicism. Take a place like sub-Saharan Africa. Do you know what the Catholic population of sub-Saharan Africa was in 1900? It was 1.9 million, 1.9. In the year 2000, it was 139 million, 139. That, ladies and gentlemen, is a growth rate of 6,708%. Put that in your pipe and smoke it, huh? 6,708%. I don't care what line of work you're in. If you've got an almost 7,000% growth rate, that ain't too bad. Okay? So let's keep our eyes on the prize. Okay? The eyes on the prize is we are not living through a period of decline. We are living through a period of dramatic growth. Okay? And just as a footnote to that, when a church grows dramatically, okay, and I know we are living through a period of importing priests from around the world to fill perceived shortages in our parishes. But the reality is that when a church grows dramatically, clergy shortages actually become worse, not better, because you can always baptize people much more rapidly than you can ordain them. We have a priest-to-person ratio in the United States of 1 to 1,300. In sub-Saharan Africa, it's 1 to 5,500. Okay, in Latin America, it's 1 to 7,800. Okay, so phenomenal growth is, of course, from a missionary point of view, a great blessing, but it also poses real challenges that we're going to be struggling to keep up with throughout the 21st century. All right, the other implication I like to unpack for American audiences is this. Let's do some basic math. As of today, July 25th, 2012, there are 1.2 billion baptized Catholics in the world, 1.2 billion, and there are roughly 67 million baptized Catholics in the United States. 67 million. What that means, ladies and gentlemen, is that American Catholics represent exactly 6% of the global Catholic population. 6%. Put another way, 94% of the Catholics in the world, in important respects, aren't like us. And by the way, if you ever wonder why the Pope is not thinking American thoughts when he gets out of bed in the morning, you know, this might have something to do with it. Okay? It's a much bigger and more complicated church out there. The point is this, if it ever was adequate, and I emphasize if, huh? If it ever was adequate to try to see the Catholic Church exclusively through the prism of American experiences, American concerns, and American priorities, trying to do that is certainly inadequate to the new global realities of the 21st century. It simply won't cut it. It doesn't do justice to who we now are. I would submit to you that in the 21st century, as we try to think about the Catholic Church, we've got basically two choices. We either learn to think globally or we think dysfunctionally. Okay, those are the only two items on the menu. Okay? So that's point one. We are an increasingly global church. All right, second descriptive observation. We are an increasingly evangelical church. Evangelical. And here, of course, I am obviously borrowing a term from our Protestant brothers and sisters and sort of translating it back into a Catholic context. Let me tell you what I mean when I say that we're an increasingly evangelical church. First, we are a church determined to revive traditional markers of Catholic identity. Okay, those traditional markers of Catholic thought, Catholic speech, Catholic practice that over the centuries have set us apart from the rest of the world and sort of told us who we are. In other words, there's a clear e-day fix in the church these days around the issue of Catholic identity, in particular, what makes Catholics different than everyone else. So at a banal, visible level, and this is really just the tip of the iceberg, but just to give you a sense of what I'm talking about things like priests wearing Roman collars, members of religious communities wearing the habit, talking about Marian devotion and Eucharistic adoration, all of this traditional, in this case, visible and tangible ways that we've sent signals of Catholic identity and Catholic distinctiveness, which in the years after the Second Vatican Council kind of went out of fashion, but today are quite clearly making a comeback. Or, to give you another very simple but tangible example, this ferment around Catholic identity, ladies and gentlemen, is why, for those of you who are Catholic, when you go to the Sunday liturgy and the celebrant says to you, "The Lord be with you," you no longer answer, "And also with you." We now say, say it with me, "And with your spirit." My point is that if you try to see that in isolation, you're going to get it wrong. You have to see it as a small piece of a much bigger picture. And the bigger picture is this thrust in the church to recapture a strong, unapologetic, clear sense of Catholic identity, to act as a kind of antidote and inoculation, if you like, against the very secular and relativistic cultural milieu in which we live. So that's the first principle of evangelical Catholicism, a sort of strong appetite for Catholic identity. And the second, of course, is to use that identity as a lever to evangelize the world. Okay, that's the essence of being evangelical, of course. You don't hide your faith under a bushel basket. You shout it from the rooftops. Okay, the buzzword par excellence in the Catholic Church these days, certainly in Rome and at the level of national bishops' conferences and individual dioceses, the buzzword par excellence in the church these days is new evangelization. Okay, the idea of trying to revive the missionary energies of the church, not simply for the purpose of attracting converts to the faith, although that's certainly at the heart of it, but more broadly to transform the secular world from the inside out in light of the gospel. Okay, that is the defining mission statement of the church these days. So to put that point differently, if you want to understand the policy-setting level of Catholicism today, why decisions are being made the way they are in the Vatican, or the National Bishops' Conference, or in diocesan chanceries all across this country, this is easily the most important trend to get your mind around. And just to make the point that this is not a journalistic hypothesis, let me cite to you no less an authority than the number two official in the Vatican's power structure, Italian Cardinal Tarcisio Bertone, who is the Vatican's Secretary of State, sort of the prime minister in the Vatican system, who was asked several years ago during a meeting with businessmen in Milan, what is the central objective of the papacy of Benedict XVI? And his answer was to recover a strong sense of Christian identity in the context of widespread secularism. Okay? A strong sense of Christian identity in the context of widespread secularism. So this is not my theory or hunch. This is the stated policy of the papacy of Benedict XVI. And I think it was also a core concern of the papacy of John Paul II, which means this has been the engine driving the policy-setting train in the Catholic Church for at least the last 30 years. But I also want to submit to you that you're going to get this ferment around Catholic identity wrong if you think of it exclusively as a top-down phenomenon, that is, something being imposed from on high, because it isn't. Okay? There is also a strong bottom-up component to it. And let me tell you where you can find it in its most pronounced form, and I'm sure this will be no newsflash to people in this room who are student affairs professionals at Catholic campuses these days. Where you can find this evangelical ethos in its most concentrated form is in a certain subsegment of the young Catholic population today. Now, I'm not talking about the broad mass of 20 and 30-something-year-old Catholics who are, of course, as you well know, all over the map in terms of faith and values and attitudes to the church and all of that. But I'm talking about that inner core of most actively committed and most actively practicing young Catholics these days. Okay? In that world, there is an evangelical milieu so thick you could cut it with a knife, sell it, and bottle it. Okay? I mean, and look, you know, let's be clear who we're talking about here. We're talking about the kind of young Catholic most likely to discern a vocation to the priesthood or religious life, most likely to enroll in a graduate program at theology, most likely to be interested in a career working for the church as a layperson in either full or part-time capacity. In other words, we are talking about the leaders of tomorrow. Okay? So my point is, vis-a-vis this evangelical thrust in the church, this concern about Catholic identity and Catholic distinctiveness, what we have, particularly in the global north, is a double whammy. This is the clear idée fixe of the leadership class of the church today, and it is also welling up from the grassroots among the leadership class of the church tomorrow, which means that ferment around Catholic identity is destined to be a defining feature of Catholic life for the rest of our lifetimes. Okay? And the debate that erupted on this campus around the commencement speech and honorary doctorate awarded to President Obama in 2009 is merely one indication of a much wider set of issues at play in the contemporary church. My advice to you is this. If hard questions around Catholic identity have not yet arrived in your neck of the woods, okay, please make sure your tray tables are in a full upright and locked position, because I guarantee you they're coming. Okay? Now, vis-a-vis this business of evangelical Catholicism and Catholic identity, it seems to me that the defining challenge we face in the 21st century is to steer a middle course between two extremes. Okay? Because every powerful movement in the life of the church always carries its shadow side. Okay? It seems to me in this case there are two potential shadow sides. At one end of the spectrum is what my friend and colleague George Weigel, I think, has perfectly correctly talked about as Catholicism light. Okay? That is a kind of watered-down, sold-out form of the faith that is really Catholic in name only, but takes its cues from the secular world. And if we take a clear-eyed, honest look around, I think we would all have to acknowledge this is a real and present danger. Okay? And we could probably all tick off examples of the phenomenon. Okay? So that's one extreme to be avoided. At the other end of the spectrum is what I have somewhat cattily referred to as Taliban Catholicism. And by that, I mean a kind of distorted form of the faith that is so fastened like a talisman in Catholic identity that all it knows how to do is excoriate and condemn and run around sort of smashing the metaphorical TV sets of the modern world. Okay? And again, I think if we are honest with ourselves, we would have to acknowledge that's a real and present danger too. Okay? So the trick is to try to navigate between those two extremes, to do justice to the legitimate concern each of those instincts carries. The Catholic light instinct has a concern for dialogue with the modern world. The Taliban instinct has a concern for identity. Both of those are legitimate, but in isolation, and if pushed too far, they become unhelpful ideologies. Okay? So what we have to do in the 21st century is recapture that genetic Catholic genius for both and solutions to what may seem to be either or problems. And again, this is not my private pet theory. Benedict XVI, in a meeting with the diocesan clergy of Velletro in northern Italy in 2007, was asked this very question. One of the priests got up and said, "Holy Father, we hear a great deal about Catholic identity, but our people come from many different places. How are we to reconcile these two things?" And the Pope's answer was that historically, the Catholic Church has always been the great religion of the both and. Okay, he actually used the Latin et, but you know, it's the same idea, right? That we need to be able to put these two instincts together in a creative synthesis rather than succumbing to the extreme version of one or the other. All right? Third, we are in the early 21st century an increasingly tribalized church. Here's what I mean by that. It is no secret, I'm sure, to anyone who has paid even a scintilla of attention to Catholic affairs in recent years, that we are, in some ways, a house divided against itself. That is, there are tremendous fault lines and divisions and rivalries and animosities in the church and all of that. Now, often, we talk about that in terms of polarization, right? We say that the church is polarized. I actually think that's profoundly misleading because it suggests that everybody is clumped either into the left or to the right. I think the more sociologically accurate term for what we are in the 21st century is tribalized. Because if we look around at the Catholic landscape, this is what we see, multiple tribes, right? We've got the Church Reform Catholics, and we've got the Liturgical Traditionalist Catholics, and we've got the Peace and Justice Catholics, and we've got the Pro-Life Catholics, and we've got the Neocon Catholics, and we've got the Obama Catholics, and we've got the movements, and on. And of course, in principle, that diversity is a marvelous thing, right? It's what makes us a church rather than a sect. But when it becomes dysfunctional is when these tribes stop communicating with one another and instead start looking upon one another as ideological, theological, and political enemies. And I would submit to you that if we're honest with ourselves, too often, that is, in fact, our situation. Okay? But what we have in the Catholic Church in the 21st century is a situation of kind of unending internal tribal combat. And the sad reality is that a distressing share of our time and treasure is devoted to this kind of internal tribal rivalry, which I would submit, if we don't fix that, is a prescription not for rising to the challenges of the 21st century, but instead being steamrolled by them. Okay? And if you'll bear with me, I'd like to tell you one final story to try to drive that point home, and then we'll be ready for some conversation. Story is this. You heard during the introduction that I grew up in rural western Kansas. Now, I don't know if anyone in this room has actually ever been to rural western Kansas. Thank you, folks. To be honest with you, I can think of no reason on God's earth why you should have been. But if you ever have been, you would know that it is not exactly a thriving crossroads of the tourist industry. In fact, the only time we get significant numbers of out-of-town visitors where I grew up is the fall, because that's pheasant hunting season. Y'all know what a pheasant is? It's a little game bird, kind of like a turkey. And there's a certain kind of guy, and yes, these are almost always guys, who finds the idea of smearing their faces with grease paint, putting on combat fatigues, and blasting shotguns in the sky over the course of a weekend to be a real hoot. Now, generally, this is done while consuming astronomic amounts of beer, so usually they're a far greater threat to one another than they are to the pheasant population. These are always great weekends for emergency rooms in western Kansas, but in any event, they come. Okay? Just to give you a sense of the cultural milieu I'm talking about, till very recently, my 98-year-old grandma lived in a little western Kansas hamlet called Hill City. It is actually my candidate for the worst place name in America, because there is no hill and there sure as hell is no city. Okay? We're talking about like 500 people on a good day, all right? Now, ladies and gentlemen, I told you before, I've traveled pretty widely. You know, I've been to some pretty funky places with the Pope and on my own. But I'm here to tell you that the one 11-room motel in Hill City, America, is the only place on God's earth I have ever stayed where there is a laminated sign in the bathroom that reads, "Please do not gut your birds in the sink." I'm not making this up. The first time I took my wife there, she said, "Is this some kind of weird sexual double entendre?" And I had to explain, "No, honey, this is face value stuff." This story is set on one weekend during pheasant hunting season. Okay? We've got an out-of-town guy, let's call him a lawyer from New York, who has come out to Graham County to try to bag himself a bird. He has spent a long and frustrating weekend with no success. And now it's time to, you know, get in his rental car and drive the 300 miles back to Kansas City to fly home to LaGuardia or whatever. But before he leaves, he decides he's going to take one last shot. So he sees a pheasant moving across the skyline. He shoulders his weapon. He fires. And miracle of miracles, he brings down the bird. So now, flush with triumph, he sets across the field to try to pick up his trophy. But just as he comes to the spot where the pheasant has fallen, there's a barbed wire fence that is clearly labeled "private property, keep out." Okay? But he's invested way too much blood, tear, toils, and sweat, so he starts to climb the fence. And just as he does so, the western Kansas farmer pulls up on his tractor and says, "Hey, buddy, what are you doing?" And the lawyer says, "Well, that's my pheasant. I'm going to pick it up." And the farmer says, "Oh, no, you're not. That bird fell on my property. It belongs to me." Okay? Now, the lawyer, of course, is hot and tired and in a hurry. He just erupts, and he says, "Look, you don't understand. I am a senior partner in a top 10 law firm in New York, and if you don't let me have that bird, I'm going to sue you back to the Stone Age." Not understanding, this is pretty much where the farmer already lives. I know, ouch, but I grew up there. I can say this stuff. Anyway. The farmer just looks at him and smiles and says, "Well, that may be how you do things where you come from. But around here, we got a little thing called the three-kick rule." "Three-kick rule, what's that about?" Farmer says, "Very simple. I kick you three times, then you kick me three times. We keep going. Whoever eventually at the end of it gives up loses the bird." Okay? And the lawyer thinks, "Well, it's probably cheaper than a lawsuit. Plus, this guy looks like he's 900 years old. You know, I can probably take him." Says, "All right, let's do it." So they line up against one another. Okay. Farmer looks at him and says, "Are you ready?" The lawyer says, "Yes, I am." Now, bear in mind, the farmer is wearing these heavy, mud-clawed western Kansas work boots, right? So he gives him one shot in the shins. The guy screams in pain. Gives him another shot in the midsection. This time, his howls of agony can be heard to the Nebraska border. And I can tell none of you people know your Western Kansas geography, because this is a fair stretch from where I'm talking about. Gives him another shot under the chin, okay? The lawyer is barely conscious. He's seeing stars. But finally, finally, with his last best ounce of effort, he hauls himself to his feet, dusts himself off, puts this look of grim determination on his face, okay? Stares the farmer in the eyes and says, "All right, you old coot, now it's my turn." And the farmer looks at him and smiles and says, "Nah, it's all right, I give up. You can have the bird." This is how we roll, Western Kansas style. Ladies and gentlemen, the foregoing has been a parable. And here is the teaching point of the parable. I would submit to you that too often our internal conversations in the Catholic Church resemble an ecclesial version of the three-kick rule. That is, too often, on those rare occasions anymore, when Catholics of differing temperaments, outlooks, visions, agenda for the future of the Church, when members of those different tribes rub shoulders, they are not really interested in a patient search for understanding. They are instead looking to score rhetorical cheap shots against people they perceive to be their ideological and theological enemies. Now, under any set of circumstances, that would be aesthetically repugnant. It would be ugly. Okay? And those of you who know anything about von Balthasar, the great Swiss theologian of the 20th century, know that there's a theological point there. If something is distant from beauty, it is probably also distant from truth. And under any set of circumstances, this tribalized way of managing our relationships would be inconsistent with the ecclesiology of communion to which both the Second Vatican Council and Popes John Paul and Benedict have repeatedly called us, the notion of the Church as a community of communities. Okay? But under the new circumstances of the 21st century I've tried to describe, of breathtaking new challenges crashing in on us from the outside and also welling up from within the Church, this ideologized, tribalized war of all against all is quite simply a death sentence. Okay? And we are going to have to change it. Okay? So let me end by teasing out three sort of mission statements for Catholic higher education based on the three observations I have given you. Okay. One, in light of the new global realities of the Church, I would suggest that Catholic higher education has the call, the providential call, to be an incubator of global perspective. An incubator of global perspective. Okay. No student, I would submit to you, ought to be able to spend 4 years on a Catholic campus without having some sense that this institution is not linked merely to a broader national religious network, but is part of a global faith community. Okay. And that the global realities of the Church and the consequent calls to North-South solidarity that implies ought to be part of the core curriculum, formally or informally. It ought to be part of the core mix of the kind of experience that students have on our campuses and in our circles of influence. Okay, so that's one, incubators of global perspective. Two, engines of healthy evangelization. Engines of healthy evangelization. And by healthy, I mean steering that middle course between the two extremes of Catholicism light and Taliban Catholicism, a legitimate concern, feeding the legitimate hunger that many young Catholics today feel for strong, clear markers of Catholic identity that set them apart from the other value systems that are on offer on the postmodern smorgasbord, but at the same time, not succumbing to a kind of narrow, angry, distorted version of that evangelization that ends up in the ghetto, that ends up circling the wagons, that ends up in the bunker, but rather that stays engaged dynamically and openly with the outside world. Okay, so engines of healthy evangelization. Okay, and then third, ladies and gentlemen, I would submit that Catholic colleges and universities have the historic opportunity and the providential vocation to become laboratories of communion. Laboratories of communion. Because let's face it, there aren't many real Catholic commons left anymore. Okay? Our parishes once upon a time played that role. Our parishes were supposed to be microcosms of the broader diversity of the church, where all of our differences dissolved around the common table of the Lord. But in a commuter culture fueled by consumer choice, we all know today our parishes are themselves in many cases tribal. We all know where the Vatican II parishes are, and the traditional parishes are, and the social justice parishes are, and the meat and potatoes parishes are, and on and on. Okay? The Catholic media doesn't play that role. And to be quite honest with you, in a number of instances, Catholic colleges and universities don't play that role. I will tell you from my experience as a journalist, quite often the most tribalized slices of life in the Catholic world are in the theology departments of Catholic colleges and universities in the United States. Which is not directly your responsibility, I understand, but it is all by way of saying that we are swimming against a powerful tide in the broader culture and also in the church. If you were going to make your institutions into laboratories of communion, it is not going to happen by accident. It is not going to happen naturally. It has to be an intentional, programmatic choice that you don't just make once and for all, but that you make day in and day out. I would submit to you, if you want a mission statement for Catholic higher education in our time, I mean, there you go. That's a good one. Incubators of global perspective, engines of healthy evangelization, and laboratories of communion. Okay, I'm going to end with one final thought, and then we'll be done. Final thought is this. In facing the challenges I've just sketched to you, it seems to me there are many qualities of heart and mind we're going to need in the 21st century. We're going to need imagination. We're going to need persistence. We're going to need fidelity and many other things. But let me give you one that I think absolutely has to be part of the mix. Okay, that's a sort of a make or break deal. And that state of heart and mind we're going to need no more than now is a sense of humor. Because, ladies and gentlemen, if we can't laugh occasionally at our foibles, we are going to spend all of our time fighting down heartburn. Okay? And the good news, folks, is that you can find a sense of humor in the church even in the most wildly improbable places. So I'm going to tell you one last story to illustrate that point, and then we'll bring the plane in for a landing. Okay, story is this. You may remember that April 2005 was kind of a busy period on the Vatican beat, right? I mean, of course, we had the long twilight of John Paul II, followed by his death, followed by those unforgettable scenes from Rome during the period between that 11-day period between his death and the funeral mass. Then, of course, the election of the new pope and the first days of the new pope and all of that. Now, you all are media savvy enough to know that when there is a major world news event, as surely as night follows day, okay, what will follow that major news event is a cottage industry of Insta books looking to cash in on the interest. Okay? And the way I know this, ladies and gentlemen, is that I participated in that cottage industry. Okay, I produced my own Insta book called The Rise of Benedict XVI. Now, there's a tradition in the Vatican Press Corps that when one of us writes a book about the Pope, we always inscribe a copy to him, and then we give it either to his personal secretary or to his spokesperson. Okay. Now, to be honest with you, it had never entered my mind that the Pope actually reads these books. Okay, I mean, in my mind's eye, I had imagined a box in the basement of the Apostolic Palace, you know, where they all sort of gather dust. But anyway, when this book came out, the Pope was elected in April. I wrote the book in May. It came out June 1. So when it came out, I dutifully inscribed a copy, and I gave it to Joaquin Navarro Valls, Spanish layman, who at the time was still the spokesperson for Benedict XVI, and forgot about it. Okay, my wife and I came back to the States. We're now in August 2005. We are actually out in Graham County, Kansas, believe it or not, visiting my 98-year-old grandma. And I got a phone call. And the phone call was from Navarro Valls, okay, the Pope's spokesperson, who at the time was with the Pope on vacation up in northern Italy. By the way, ladies and gentlemen, I can't prove this to you empirically, but I am morally convinced this was the first time in history a phone call had been placed from the papal household to Graham County, Kansas. Because I can think of no other circumstances in which this might have happened. But anyway, Navarro said, well, John, I'm here with the Pope on vacation, and I wanted you to know he came down to breakfast this morning with your book in his hands, and he asked me to deliver to you a message. Now, I don't know about you, okay? But if you've just been told the Pope has a personal reaction to something you've written about him, you know, I would want to make sure that those seat belts are fastened tight, you know, because the skies might get a little bumpy. But I said to Joaquin, well, that's marvelous. Of course, what's the message? Now, to understand this, you need to know that the book was divided into thirds, okay? So the first third were the final days of John Paul II. The middle third was the inside story of how Cardinal Joseph Ratzinger was elected as Pope Benedict XVI. The last third was my projections as to where his papacy would go, okay? So Navarro said, well, the Holy Father said the following. He said, please thank Herr Dr. Allen for having written this book, particularly the last third about the future of my papacy, because it has saved me the trouble of thinking about it for myself. I like to think he was kidding. Ladies and gentlemen, that to me seems the heart of a successful strategy, a winning strategy, if you like, for Catholicism in the 21st century. If we can take a clear-eyed look at the mammoth challenges facing us, if we can step back and think carefully and hard and critically about what it means to be a global church, about what the demands of a healthy evangelization are, about the challenges of communion vis-a-vis the tribalized environment in which we live. If we can do all of that, but if we can do it with a twinkle in our eye rather than, you know, bile in our spleen, that to me seems a winning strategy for Catholicism every day of the week and twice on Sunday. Thank you and God bless you. Now, we've got a little under 20 minutes for Q&A. Here's what I would propose to you. If you can just raise your hand, don't worry about a microphone coming to you. Just I'll be able to hear you, and then I'll just briefly repeat your question so we pick it up on the recording. Sir, you'll be first. Let me first, however, give you both an invitation and a warning. Okay? Invitation is this. Okay? You obviously are welcome to ask anything you like about the presentation you just heard. But don't feel restricted to that. I mean, if there's something else on your mind, I mean, if there's some huge policy question that you think is like the 800-pound gorilla in the room that we got to talk about, fine. If you just have idle Vatican curiosity, like if you want to know, is it true that Benedict XVI prefers orange Fanta to red wine with dinner? Yes, that is true. So, you know, whatever is on your mind, I may not necessarily know the answer to your question, but ladies and gentlemen, part of the way I make my living is on American TV. Absolute ignorance has never been a bar to talking about something before, and I see no reason why it should be here today. Now, the warning is this. I'm getting paid to stand here until 10 after the hour, whether you have questions or not. So if you don't ask questions, I am simply going to stand here and tell you more Pope jokes. And I promise you, this is not a consummation devoutly to be wished. Okay. Yes, sir.
Well, let me say, I admire your taste in oratory.
This is perhaps more of an observation than a question, but the question embedded in it. I'm at Seton Hall University. We're sort of in the shadow of New York City, or the glow of New York City, however you want to look at it. NYU sends more students abroad, that I believe, proportionately at least, than any other institution in America, you know, to study abroad. They have like six or eight campuses around the world in various world capitals. At my own institution, I mean, we sort of talked and struggled and wrestled for years about globalization and how do we get more students to go abroad and this and that. It just seems to me, I mean, Catholic higher education is part of the first truly global institution in human history.
Absolutely.
There is a network of institutions around the world in the developing world, in Europe, in Asia, all over. And it just seems to me that this is a no-brainer to be beaten by sort of upstart institutions that were starting in the 18th and 19th century.
On behalf of NYU, let me thank you for calling it an upstart. So why aren't we doing better?
Why aren't we doing better? Is there going to be any leadership from the Vatican making it easier? Like, I would love to have a student be able to go to make it easy for a student to go and do a semester in the Philippines or in Uganda, or, you know, to just like transfer from one institution to another? Is there any talk, any thinking around that?
All right, so the question is, the Catholic Church is, of course, human history's first truly globalized institution. I mean, we were globalized before globalization was cool. And yet secular institutions often do a better job, secular higher education institutions sometimes do a better job of encouraging students to study abroad than we do. Is there some hope of turning that around? First of all, as you are well aware, there are plenty of good, compelling examples of Catholic institutions that do send their people abroad. Now, I would say that my experience is that much more often they send them to Europe than any place else, in Rome in particular. I mean, I can tick off a dozen Catholic institutions that have Rome abroad programs because I'm routinely asked to speak at all of them, okay? And I think that's a very healthy thing. I mean, listen, I learned more about the Catholic Church in the United States from 10 years in Rome than I ever did here, because here I knew my backyard. There I saw a little piece of everything, you know? So I think it's a healthy experience. But if you are starting to plan something from the ground up, I would encourage people to think bigger than that, because Rome and Europe is not the only game in town. It accounts for an ever-shrinking percentage of the global Catholic population and so on. I mean, for example, there is a brand new, founded in 1992, new Catholic university in Honduras, the Catholic University of Central America, in Tegucigalpa, founded under the patronage of Cardinal Oscar Rodriguez Maradiaga, who is one of the more dynamic Latin American prelates, also the president of Caritas Internacionalis. That would be, it's a fairly easy get from many parts of the United States. Okay, Catholic University in Peru and other places in Latin America. In other words, I think there are places beyond the West one could think about. And you mentioned Uganda. Uganda is another great example. Now, in Uganda, they are just now trying to start a Catholic university, but they also have an extraordinarily strong Newman Center at Makerere University, which is sort of the Ugandan Harvard, that would also be a natural partner for lots of Catholic outfits in the state. So I think if you take a clear-eyed look around, there are plenty of opportunities, and I'm not sure that the resources are necessarily the most daunting piece of it. But let me make one other point, okay? Because I think the question you're asking is great, and I think looking around the world at places where we can plug into the new global realities is terrific. But let's be clear, to find this increasingly multicultural, multilingual, polychrome Catholicism that I've been describing, you don't need to go to Tegucigalpa or Kampala. Ladies and gentlemen, all you need to do is walk out the door of this building. Okay, because increasingly, the American Catholic Church in microcosm is a fairly faithful reflection of the broader global realities I've been describing. Let me tell you, according to the Pew Forum, they picked 2030 as a looming watershed year in American Catholicism. Because based on their projections, in 2030, for the first time, white Catholics will no longer be a statistical majority of the American Catholic population. Okay, whites will still be a plurality at 48%, but Hispanics, that is Latinos and Latinas, will be 41%, Asians and Asian Americans will be 7.5%, Africans and African Americans 3.5% to 4%. Okay. I mean, in other words, trying to think through the implications of the rise of a global church is not just an abstract gesture of solidarity with the rest of the world. It's also a very concrete, practical, sleeves-rolled-up matter of getting ready to do anything at all in the church that is taking shape in our own backyard. So back to the point you asked. Look, I would encourage Seton Hall to think about plugging into the Catholic University in Honduras, or for that matter, you know, Louvain, or whatever seems to be the best fit. But I would also suggest take a look at the parishes that are taking shape right now in New Jersey. I mean, the new global realities of those places, and ask yourself, how can you lift that up and create space at Seton Hall for thinking through the ministerial and evangelical implications of that, okay? I mean, in other words, you don't have to go looking for it. It's going to find you, okay? What else do we have? Yes, ma'am.
Is the content of your lunch today in any way related to your latest book in the interview with
Question is the content of what I talked about today in any way related to my latest book, which, by the way, available at fine bookstores everywhere, and, you know, the holidays are going to be upon us before you know it. Perfect stocking stuffer for that special Catholic in your life. So the latest book is called A People of Hope, and it's a book-length interview with Cardinal Timothy Dolan in New York, which was actually modeled, the Pope did a book-length interview with a German journalist 3 years ago, so the idea for the book kind of came out of that, because he's the closest thing that we have in the United States to an American Pope, you know? So the question is the content of today's presentation related to that? I mean, sort of. I mean, I ask him questions about this. Actually, one of the very interesting conversations I had with Dolan was about this issue of priest shortages, okay, and the increasing reliance in the United States on importing priests from abroad. I mean, I don't know if you know, but here are the numbers. 1 out of every 6 Catholic priests in the United States today is foreign-born. We add about 300 new international priests every year, okay? You know that little Western Kansas hamlet I told you about? You know who the pastor there is now? It's a Donum Fide priest from Myanmar, okay? Now, to be honest, if you ask my grandma, she's going to tell you that Father Henry is Chinese, because that's as far as she can get. But, I mean, listen, believe me when I tell you, those people in rural Western Kansas were thrilled to have him, because from their point of view, the choice was not between a strange talking priest from some place in Asia or a corn-fed Kansas farm boy. Okay, the choice was between the strange talking guy from Asia and no priest at all. Okay, so these guys are great blessings when they show up, but there are also real questions of justice here we have to think about. I mean, look, 2/3 of our people globally are in the South, but 2/3 of our priests are in the North. Okay, if you were a systems analyst, it wouldn't take you long to figure out there's a serious mismatch of resources here. All right? Again, I told you, let's just run the numbers. A ratio of 1 priest for every 1,300 Catholics in Europe and the United States, but it's 1 to 5,500 in sub-Saharan Africa, 1 to 7,800 in Latin America, 1 to 8,300 in Southeast Asia. Okay, so however bad you may think our priest shortages are, they're infinitely worse pretty much every place else. Now, you have to ask the question, why did and bishops down there know that, obviously, so why do they allow their guys to come? Now, part of it is there's a theology of a reverse mission these days. I mean, church leaders in the South are profoundly convinced that just as they were evangelized by the West 2 centuries ago, today it's their turn to sort of return the favor. So that's part of it. But part of it, to be honest with you, is money. Okay? Because when a bishop sends one of his guys over, 3 things happen. First, he gets a lump sum payment from the diocese where the guy is going to serve. Secondly, the guy will send a portion of his salary back. And third, that guy can participate in the annual diocesan mission appeal during the summer, so he can go parish to parish taking special collections for his church back home. Okay? These churches are, in a certain sense, they're people rich and cash poor. Okay? Now, I think in justice, we have to ask the question, is there a way that we could be of support to these growing churches in the global South that doesn't actually end up sort of fueling a brain drain and making their pastoral situation even worse, okay? I asked Dolan that question. You know what his answer was? It's fascinating. His answer was, that is a great question, and I wish as a bishop I had some time to think about it. He said, unfortunately, so much of our time is consumed by, you know, the insurance mandates dispute with the White House and, you know, crackdown on the nuns and trying to clean up from all this other stuff. That, you know, we really, and liturgical debates. I mean, these guys spent 20 years debating whether we should say, and also with you, or and with your spirit, right? And I mean, no prejudice to my liturgist friends. I know that language shapes culture. Language is important, okay? But there are other issues out there, okay? And I thought Dolan's answer was revealing that there's nothing in the system that ensures we have time to think about this stuff. Back to my point about why it's so important that you create spaces for doing it. And that's exactly what Dolan said, because at another section in this conversation, we were talking about Notre Dame and the dispute over Obama, right? And Dolan was saying, as far as he was concerned, that situation wasn't completely resolved. And I asked him, well, what would count to you as evidence that Catholic universities are truly trying to work constructively with the bishops? Granted, you got a difference over who you give degrees to, all right? But, you know, what would count as evidence that things are moving in the right direction? And his answer was, create spaces for us to have these conversations. Okay. Now, that's my way of saying, if you read that book, you will find bits and pieces of this presentation. But actually, I mean, if you want the data and a more comprehensive sort of overview of the stuff we talked about this morning, the better bet is my 2009 book, The Future Church, because it outlines 10 trends shaping the future of the Catholic Church, including the ones we talked about today. Yes, sir, over there on the wing.
Sir, terms of your point about no evangelization, it seems like recycling media is the vehicle for controlling American thought. And the Catholic red button issues on sexuality and abuse and women's issues, they seem to be the only thing that get in the media in the most negative expression. And so students coming into the university, the college, bring that brand of Catholicism with them. And how do we, in a certain way, face that kind of identity with the new evangelization? And is there any way to have a power against this kind of overall secular media that seems so negative against the church?
All right, so the question is about the media. And if we're going to talk about evangelization, don't we have to face the fact that the most powerful instrument for evangelization in this country ain't under the control of the Catholic Church, it's the secular media. And the secular media tends to have a certain agenda when it comes to coverage of the Catholic Church that tend to focus on controversy, scandal, and crisis. So young people come in with those things in their heads. What do we do about it? That's the question, right? Well, look, I've often said, and listen, I straddle both worlds, right? I mean, I am a professional Vatican correspondent. I'm also a Catholic, so I spend a lot of my time in the church world. I'm also a media professional, so I move back and forth between these two cultures. And I will tell you, in many ways, this is a perfect storm, okay? I mean, on the side of the media, let's face the facts, religion generally is not taken seriously as a news beat, okay? We don't invest anything like the resources we do in politics or finance or sport, even sports and entertainment, okay, in covering religion or the Catholic Church, which means it's a very narrow canon of issues that tend to punch through the fog. And the problem really isn't so much explicit bias, it's just ignorance. I mean, it's religious illiteracy. No, in my line of work, people are not encouraged to develop professional competence in covering religion the way they are in other areas, okay? That's the media piece of the picture. On the church side, I mean, I think to call our track record in media relations mixed is putting it pretty damn charitably, okay? I mean, when it comes to the Vatican, you know, when people ask me about the Vatican's communication strategy, usually my answer is, as soon as I see evidence that they've got one, I'll tell you what I think about it, okay? And so, you know, you've got two cultural worlds in some ways that are almost designed not to understand one another particularly well, you know, in sort of constant collision. Now, I'd love to tell you that a new heaven and a new earth is about to arrive, okay? I'd love to tell you, okay, that on the side of the media, that there has been a kind of Kairos moment, and, you know, in the near term, suddenly, you know, religion is going to take its place as a privileged news beat. I once thought that was going to happen. I remember back in those days of April 2005, you remember the estimate from the city of Rome was that in that 10-day period between the death of the Pope and the funeral mass, something like 5 million Romans showed up, and an estimated 5 to 10 million people from outside the city, from all over the world, came through. So you had, you remember those rivers of humanity washing through Rome in those days? On CNN, we interviewed a guy from Chicago who had heard the news that the Pope had died, packed a bag. He was a garbage man. That doesn't seem right, but it was a blue-collar occupation, okay? He heard the news the Pope had died, packed a bag, took a cab to O'Hare, okay, got on a flight to Fiumicino, thinking he would go pay his respects, that he would have 2 or 3 days to look around Rome, and then he would come home, right? Used up all the vacation days he had. Landed, took a cab with his bag, took a cab from Fiumicino in Rome to St. Peter's Square, or as close as he could get to it by that stage. You remember those lines. He spent the next 72 hours in line, okay? Never left that line. The next 72 hours, waiting for those fleeting 10 or 15 seconds before the casket of the Pope to say a prayer and pay his respects. By that stage, his vacation time was over. He just picked up his bag, got in another cab, went back to Fiumicino, and flew home. And he told us on air it was the most moving experience of his life. Now, you multiply that by 15 million times. Okay, that was the story of those days. And I remember we were, the CNN viewing locations was at the top of the Urban College, which looks down from the Janiculum Hill, looks down in St. Peter's Square. And I was with Aaron Brown one morning, who at that stage was still hosting, this was before the Anderson Cooper revolution at CNN. So Aaron Brown was still hosting the main evening news program. And of course, in Rome, primetime in the States is about, it starts at about 1 o'clock in the morning and ends at about 5 o'clock in the morning, okay? So this is around 4 o'clock, we're on break. Aaron and I were the only two smokers in the CNN crew, so we were off in a corner having a smoke break. And Aaron, you have to understand, is a classic sort of secular Jew. I mean, the guy does not have a religious bone in his body, right? And he never really thought about religion. But we were standing there looking down at those crowds, hearing those hauntingly beautiful Latin hymns, you know, the Te Deum and Nos Nobis, you know, play over the loudspeakers, the incredible prayerful atmosphere. Aaron looked down and he said, God, you know, there's just something about this whole religion thing that I don't get. He said, but now I know that I need to get it. Okay. So there was that moment, you know, when I actually sort of fell for it. I drank the Kool-Aid and believed that that experience was going to have such a mammoth cultural impact that it would revolutionize religion reporting. Well, you know, here we are 7 years later. I can tell you it didn't happen. Okay, it lasted about a week. Okay, so I'm not going to stand here, you know, and sugarcoat the reality. The reality is that media coverage of the Catholic Church is going to largely, secular media coverage, is going to continue to be episodic, and it's going to be driven by crisis, scandal, and controversy. It's going to be, and it's often going to miss bigger pieces of the picture. That is, it's going to be selective and partial. And on the church side, I wish I could tell you again that the October Revolution is about to arrive, you know, but I can't tell you that either. I mean, it is true that the Vatican just hired a veteran American journalist to be its new communications Svengali, a friend of mine by the name of Greg Burke, and I think he'll do a good job, but the truth is he is swimming against a cultural tide there that I think sort of defies any one person's efforts. The problem on the church side, you know, is that for almost 27 years, we had the sexiest news story in the world at the top of the pyramid, okay, in John Paul II, right? You might like him or not, but I mean, everything that guy did was news, okay? There was no room he ever walked into that he didn't dominate, okay? Quick story about John Paul. In 83, this was after martial law had been imposed in Poland, okay? And this was the first time that Lech Walesa, you all know that name, the founder of the Solidarity Movement? So Walesa, of course, knew Cardinal Wojtyla back in Krakow, but this was the first time he had met the Pope since his election, okay? And I don't know if you've ever been to one of these sort of semi-private papal audiences, but the way it works is that the group is brought in and the VIPs sit in the first couple rows, then the Vatican entourage comes in on either side of the papal throne, then the Pope walks in and sits down. Somebody gives a little speech on behalf of the group, then the Pope gives a speech, then and only then at the very end are the VIPs brought up to be introduced, right? That's the protocol. Well, on this particular day, Walesa, either nobody had briefed him or he just didn't give a damn, because the moment that John Paul walked in the room, Walesa rushed at him, fell at his feet, grabbed his hand, and planted a kiss on his ring. Okay. Now, the papal photographer obviously was not expecting this to happen, so he was out of position changing a roll of film. He didn't get the shot. John Paul caught that out of the corner of his eye, and he told Walesa to get up and do it again. Okay. Because he knew. He knew that picture was going to finish on the front page of every newspaper in the world. And what it was going to say in a flash is that this guy is not some, you know, radical firebrand, but he's a loyal son of the church whom I embrace. Okay. And he knew that was going to say more in an instant than any 800-word news story or papal speech ever would. Okay. Now, John Paul was one of those freak of nature, instinctive communications geniuses. But, you know, because we had him there, I think people thought in some ways the Vatican and the church had sort of cleaned up its act, that it had changed its tone in terms of communication strategy. No, it was the same dysfunctional system operating according to the same dysfunctional principles. It's just that you couldn't see it for 26 years because you had John Paul there. Now, you take John Paul away, and we're back to the same old system. And unfortunately, the media world has changed a little bit in the intervening 26 years. Huh? So we're, in fact, further behind, I think, than we were 26 years ago. And I would love to tell you that's going to change. I'm not sure I can sell you that piece of the Brooklyn Bridge either. So what I can tell you is this. In terms of evangelization, and particularly trying to promote the kind of Catholic literacy that's a pre-step to evangelization, because the thing is, if you're going to evangelize somebody, often the first thing you have to do is debunk some of the stereotypes and prejudices they're carrying around, right? I mean, before we can talk about, the communion of saints and, you know, sort of prayerful entry into that sort of spirituality, if they're walking around thinking that the Catholic Church is a den of pedophiles, you got to deal with that first, right, before they're going to listen to you about anything else. Now, being able to promote that kind of literacy, My message to you is don't rely on the secular media to do it, and don't rely on the official structures of the church to do it. If it's going to be done, you're going to have to do it for yourself. I mean, my point would be that I think we all have to think of ourselves as kind of brokers of Catholic literacy on the retail level in our own circles of influence, okay, our own parishes, our own networks of friends, our own schools, the professional associations that we move in. Okay, when a hot-button issue about the church erupts, I think we have to, first of all, you've got to educate yourself. Unfortunately, there are resources for doing that. But my point is that you need to own for yourself the role of being the person who steps up and says, look, let me tell you what's really going on here, or at least give my read on it. Okay. Again, I'd like to tell you that you could rely on the New York Review of Books to do that for you. I'd like to tell you that you could rely on the Communications Office of the United States Conference of Catholic Bishops to do it. My experience suggests to me that in neither case should you rely on them to do that, and therefore you have to do it for yourselves. Okay? Okay, listen, before they pull the plug on this act, let me say one last thing, which is I want this to be the beginning of a conversation among us rather than the end, okay? That is, I don't just want to sort of parachute out of here and have no further contact with you. So let me say this. If there is ever any way I can be of help to someone in this room, I have no earthly idea what that might be, but if in your student affairs office you're trying to brainstorm a speaker who could talk about global Catholic realities and you think I might be able to give you an idea or two, you want a reading recommendation for some adult study group here. I mean, for God's sakes, folks, if you're coming to Rome and you want restaurant recommendations, this is where I truly shine. Okay. I have an online column. It's called All Things Catholic. If you just Google John Allen, All Things Catholic, it will come up. At the bottom is my email address. Now, if you're going to contact me that way, please put, like, you know, student affairs or something in the subject line, so I don't think you're the eighth Nigerian prince today who's going to give me $80 million if I just give him my bank account details, right? But assuming that you permeate my spam filter, all right, if I can be of help, I would be delighted to do that. And listen, believe me, okay, I need to walk my own talk. If I'm going to go around talking about how places need to be laboratories of communion and we need a spirit of friendship, then that can't just be hollow verbiage. I actually have to mean it. So if there is some way that I can help you, it will not be an imposition. It will be an opportunity for me to feel like a person of integrity. Okay, so please do take advantage of it. Thank you. God bless you. Peace out.
On behalf of Notre Dame and St. Mary's, the organizers of the ASACCU conference and the attendees, I want to thank you in the deepest way for your humor, your intellect, your insight. I take what you've shared with us today as both a charge and a commissioning to student affairs professionals in higher education. So again, thank you. Please join me in thanking John again.